Happy prototyping, everyone! In today's project, we want to convert this time switch into a smart switch. Therefore, we need the following components. The ESP8266 will be the brain of the operation. We also need this electronic relay to switch the main supply. Additionally, this power supply will supply our components. In the end, we can also use this display to show useful information. A word of warning in the beginning. If you don't know what you're doing, don't try to reconstruct this project. It's very dangerous to work with mains electricity. And also, if something goes wrong and your home burns down, for example, you will be responsible. In the first step of our project, we will modify the time switch case to fit the new components. The case is not designed to be used for this purpose, so I'm using the Dremel to modify it. My main focus is to separate the main voltage as much as possible from the secondary low voltage part. This should reduce the risk of spark overs, and therefore also the risk of a catastrophic failure. I'm not 100% happy with the result. There's just not enough space to get a good separation. But it should be good enough if the device is handled with a bit of care. In the next step, we will add a fuse. This is an additional measure to avoid a catastrophic failure. If something goes wrong and the device, for example, draws more current, which can lead to a fire, the fuse will just blow. There is not enough space to use a fuse holder. Instead, I just directly soldered the fuse to a cable. This can be annoying during development, because if you make any shorts during testing, the fuse needs to be replaced. I'm using the heat shrink to cover as much of the exposed mains electricity as possible to reduce the risk to get electrified during the development process. The ESP8266, the transformer and the electronic switch are all bought from Banggood's, and the time switch is actually from IKEA. So I think the total material cost will be around 10 euros. You can buy smart Wi-Fi switches from Banggood's starting at 5 euro. So there's actually no point to make this build yourself. Now we have complete a part of the circuit. The supply and the electronic relay are already installed. So I have this lamp. If I plug it in, you can see it glows orange. So now we can plug in the circuit, and I've just connected the electronic relay directly to the supply. So if I switch this switch, it will turn on the electrical relay, and therefore the lamp should start to glow. We'll see. It's not glowing, and if I turn it on, it's glowing. So perfect, we can continue. To use the ESP8266, we need a PCB. So in the next step of the project, we will design a PCB to fit in the small space left in the time switch case. I copied the circuit used in the word clock project to start from. One problem we need to solve is how to control the 5 volt input of the electronic relay with a 3.3 I/O port of the ESP8266. One solution is to use an NPN transistor and connect it in series with the electronic relay. Done to the limited space, we would actually need a two-sided PCB. But I decided to make it one-sided and solder some components directly to pins of other components. If I would plan to build more than one smart switch, I would not do that. But this way we can save some time in the fabrication of the PCB. There was also no space left for the connection to the display. So we will need to directly solder it to the ESP8266 I/O pins. We use the LM317 to generate the 3.3 volts for the ESP8266 and the display. Therefore, the same circuit is used as in the word clock project. Additionally, I removed some filter capacitors to further reduce the component count. The connector in the lower left corner will be used for programming the ESP8266. The components and connection on the bottom layer, here displayed in blue, will be mounted without the help of the PCB. In the next step, we will convert the PCB into G-code. This is possible with the help of the program called PCB G-code generator. The G-codes are then sent to my Proxon mill. In the first step, a height map of the PCB is generated, to later correct all moves. For this process, I use my own developed program called CNC G-code controller. Have fun watching the speeded up video of the PCB fabrication process. In the next step, we start to assemble the PCB. Next step is to develop the firmware for the ESP8266. There is actually not much to do. The Arduino community already developed all necessary libraries. To make it possible that Google Home or Alexa is able to control the switch, I found a ready-to-use library called FoxMo ESP. This library uses callback function, so it's very easy to integrate it in an existing project. To control the display, I also use an existing library from Daniel Eichborn and Fabric Weinberg. I hope I spelled the name correctly. I just use it to display text, but the library is also capable to display images and animations. Additionally, to these libraries, I use the Wi-Fi Manager library to make it easier to switch between Wi-Fi networks. If the saved Wi-Fi is not found, the ESP 8266 will open an hotspot and host a website to set a new Wi-Fi network. So to build our firmware, it's more or less just copy and paste the code from the different example codes from each library. The only problem I had was that my Wi-Fi signal was too weak. This caused some instabilities, and I did not understand the cause in the beginning. After using a Wi-Fi repeater, everything works perfectly. I'm personally really impressed from the Arduino community. A lot of people take it for granted, but if you're working with other microcontrollers, there is often nothing you can use out of the box. You normally have to write everything from scratch or port existing libraries from other platforms. This process can be very time consuming and should be taken into account when planning a bigger project. Now we are nearly finished. In the last step, we want to build a cover for the display. I decided to use 3D printing to make the cover. So first we must design the object we want to print. For that, I really like to use OpenSCAD. It feels like a programming language for 3D objects. You can use simple shapes like cubes, cylinders, and operations like transformation, union, and difference to build more complex structures. So you don't have to learn how to use a complex user interface. Just type what you want. The code is then used to generate an STL file, which can be processed by other tools. After finishing the modulation, I use Slicer to generate the G-code for the 3D printer. Now we just have to clean up the finished part and glue it in place. I will use the last minute of this video to talk a little bit about my YouTube channel. You will have recognized that there were not so much video lately. I had some big changes in my life in the last time. First, my 3-month-old child needs a lot of attention. Secondly, I opened a company which also takes some of my free time. But don't worry, I will not give up my YouTube channel. I have a lot of ideas for new videos. There will be just not so many in the next month. So, now back to the project. We are finished with the build, so now to the result. Computer, turn on switch.
Okay.
Computer, turn off switch.
Okay.